book has been on the New York Times bestseller list, number one, the last 6 weeks, and been in the top 10 since it came out. They're into their second printing, which is a second printing of 250,000 books. So it's not surprising, because it is such an incredible story that really seems like it's fiction. So how many people have either read Unbroken or are in the process of reading it? Okay. Well, I'm anxious. I've been jumping to different parts. I feel like I know the story so well, and yet so many have told me that Laura Hillenbrand was able to find out, and Louis told me this, even things about his life that he didn't know. So it took about 6 years for her to do. She has chronic fatigue, and so it just takes her a long time to write, but it looks like she's really covered everything. A lot of original photos, too, that she's uncovered, spread throughout the book. But this story of survival, redemption, and forgiveness, it's the most extraordinary story I've ever heard. You feel like it can't possibly be real, almost. But, you know, I think, too, it juxtaposes nicely with these stories that we talk about in this class, like, the big money contracts in the NBA and the NFL. We're talking about a strike in the NFL. We're talking about maybe a strike in the NBA. And, you know, the kind of money they're talking about now, contracts that are $20, $25 million, and teams can't afford players. And I just think about, you know, somebody like Louis, where, you know, it's such a story of the strength and resilience, and just of the human heart. And, you know, it just kind of really brings you back to the basics. So I'm really glad this is coming, that we can kind of take a pause in the semester about halfway through, you know, and really look at, you know, with all the bling bling going on in pro sports and this past weekend in the NBA. And here's somebody who's went through what he did, and now he's spending the rest of his life sharing his message with as many people as he can, and he's just grateful to be able to do it. He never asked for anything. He comes from a generation that, he says, you don't have to call us the greatest generation. We were a hardy bunch. So he'll sign a book or whatever, piece of paper, he'll put "Be Hardy" on it, because that's what he feels is most important. It's not about the greatest this. It's like, we did what we had to do. We did what we had to do to survive, and we did the right thing. But be hardy, and that's his constant message. So I want you to think about that. My friend, you know, Steve and I were running the other day, and I said to him, Steve, how many people do you think, how many Americans, not counting Germans that might have been there, how many Americans do you think can say that they shook the hand of Adolf Hitler? I mean, it doesn't even seem real. And he said, you know, I would say probably one. It's probably Louis. That's probably it. And as our heroes from that time in World War II, as they leave us over these next few years, I mean, somebody like Louis, I hope you'll appreciate this moment tonight even more, because if he comes three or four more times to my class, he's 94 now, that'll be a total of maybe 10. He's come about six times. So that means 10 classes, 10 groups like this will have had a chance to meet him and hear his story in person. You know, the book, the video, that will live on and will be around forever. But him here, you know, there's 10 classes of you guys that have been able to do that. So this really is like a piece of world history, living history. And you take a walk out to the track, and you walk inside just as you enter the stadium from out here, the side on the PE building side, there's Zamperini Plaza. And you'll see a little kind of corner there dedicated to Louis. So I hope you'll honor his legacy by just being the best people you can be and continuing to do the right thing. I wanted to just also share with you a couple of the things a couple of the students had sent to me over the years when I've asked them their feelings about Louis after having seen him, met him in class. First was this quick review that Peter King, I've mentioned before, from Sports Illustrated. He wrote, he just read Unbroken, and he had a little item in his column about the book. And I think those of you that are reading it will certainly relate to this. This is what he said about it. A few days off gave me the chance to polish off one of the books I've been dying to read, Unbroken, by Laura Hillenbrand, who got our attention a few years ago with the masterfully told horse racing epic Seabiscuit. Unbroken is a tale I'll carry with me for years, a story of a World War II hero I'm shocked I never heard of until a week ago. Because Laura Hillenbrand's incredible narrative of Louis Zamperini makes him one of the most unforgettable characters I've ever read about. There should be schools named after Zamperini, towns. I don't want to give away too much, but if you get this book only to read about surviving adversity and surviving more adversity than man has ever encountered, you'd be well off. I recommend this book highly. You get so attached to Zamperini, his roller coaster life, that you are magnetized to Unbroken. Ever read a book late into the night and look over at the clock and see that it's 2 a.m. and know you're going to be in big trouble in the morning because you'll wake up fatigued, but you can't put it down anyway? This happened to me twice last week with Unbroken. And a comment from a student from a couple of years ago. Sometimes life just does not seem so great, but it's how we deal with all of that that matters. How we act and behave during those hard times is what builds our character. Zamperini was a survivor, and I will think about him whenever I feel like survival is impossible. He endured the hardest of times and still came out an incredible man. Another wrote, the most important life lessons that I personally learned from Mr. Zamperini's appearance in class is to never give up. This quote, a minute of pain is worth a lifetime of glory, really resonated with me because I think it's so true. Live the moment, don't ever give up, and always try to think positive and be optimistic. If you hold grudges or let other people's stress and pessimism get to you, you will not be happy. The most important lesson I learned was one of the possibilities of redemption in life. Here's Zamperini, a juvenile delinquent involved in gangs, who turns his life around and becomes mentioned by nuns who work with Mother Teresa. It really applies to my personal family life. As the eldest child, my younger brother had his own brush with an ill-reputable lifestyle, and I honestly did not know if he could come back from it. I know now the arc of possibility after Zamperini. Another wrote, the most valuable lesson I learned from Mr. Zamperini is determination. I can't imagine how many times he must have wanted to give up on that raft or in that prison camp. The determination and willpower it must have taken to overcome the stress of being at sea or in prison is a lesson for everyone. He never gave up, and because of that, he is able to tell his amazing story to this day. Mr. Zamperini is a true hero, and his story has inspired me, not just my athletics, but academically and my overall life. He makes you strive to be the best person you can be. And then one more. There is no way to select only a few important life lessons from this amazing man. Everything about him is awe-inspiring and makes me want to live every day to the fullest and to my fullest potential. If I had to choose a life lesson, it would have to be perseverance. There is a reason certain people succeed and others do not, and I believe this has to do with the willpower to keep on keeping on as much as it does with the individual belief that you will survive. Mr. Zamperini puts things into perspective and has an aura about him that inspires the drive to persevere. Nothing is impossible, not even surviving 45 plus days on a raft in the middle of the ocean. The last one. Last night I got to meet a hero, Louis Zamperini. The listing of his accomplishments could never touch the greatness of this man. His has been a life lived to the fullest, lived well, lived with courage, and most of all characterized by great hope and honest faith. He has seen the darkest capabilities of the human heart, and he has kept on living and loving, staring down the threats of cynicism and bitterness presented by years of hunger, torture, and humiliation. With the help of my faith and my family, I also look forward to living life to the fullest. And someday I will be 88, still skiing, still sharing my life, and still looking forward to the next 10 years, just like Lou. Louis was skiing until he was a day before his 90th birthday. He got upset because he felt people were not being very courteous on the slopes, and it was getting too challenging for him to get out of the way of people that were flying by, so he gave up skiing at 90, but he was still skateboarding until he was 80. So, hope that's somewhat inspiring for everybody. We'll see the video now, and then we'll talk about it and welcome Louis afterwards.
Welcome back to Ceremony Stadium on this closing night of the Nagano Games. One of the great showdowns of these games came at White Ring, the duel between Tara Lipinski of Sugar Land, Texas, and Michelle Kwan of Torrance, California. It turns out that Kwan isn't the first Olympian from Torrance. There was another who also came to the Nagano area, but under very different circumstances. It isn't a story so much about the Olympics as it is about the survival of the human spirit. CBS News correspondent Bob Simon takes us through this epic tale.
If you drove 40 minutes from the Olympic stage in Nagano, you'd come across this strange memorial. There's nothing like it anywhere else in Japan. It may not mean much to the sports fans gathering all around here, but an American Olympian of another time came here once and left a part of himself on this ground. You've probably never heard of him, but this is the incredible story of his life.
This is your life. Now, the life we are about to relive is an American saga of courage and stamina that perhaps has no equal in the annals of sports or war, from the heroes of ancient Greece to our own day. For tonight, ladies and gentlemen, this is your life, Louis Zamperini. Louis Zamperini.
Louis Zamperini never seemed destined for fame. Anyone who knew him as a kid thought he'd be more likely to wind up in trouble than on television.
Louis was a pain in the neck. In the old days, we only had one police car in town. So if it went south, Louis went north.
I started getting in trouble because of the kids liked to hear me swear in Italian, so they were always picking on me to hear me swear in Italian.
He was the son of Italian immigrants, and this was Torrance, California, a tough neighborhood outside Los Angeles. Louis never signed up for a class he couldn't skip, never saw a freight train he couldn't hop.
I started smoking, by the way, when I was 5 years old.
Torrance's police chief, Jerry Calder, knew him as a kid who was so fast on his feet that he managed to steal beer from bootleggers. It was Calder and older brother Pete who tried to convince Louis to run in another direction.
The first race Lou got in, he won and heard his name. All the guys yelled, "Come on, Lou, come on." And I guess that turned him, because it was from there on out. He had a different outlook on life.
Losing was not for Louis. He became the sensation of Torrance High School. In May 1934, at the high school state finals, he unleashed the devastating kick that was becoming his trademark and set a new world record for the high school mile.
He had an interview, and it wasn't 30 seconds after he finished the race, and he wasn't breathing. He was uncanny.
Uncanny? The second time he ran 5,000 meters, he qualified for the U.S. Olympic trials in New York City. It was July, 1 month before the 1936 Olympics in Berlin.
The city dads, when they gave me my suitcase, they had painted on the outside the Torrance Tornado. And I was embarrassed. I finally got a roll of adhesive tape, and I put it over the Torrance Tornado. I didn't want to get on the train with all these great athletes, and a little punk high school kid comes in there with Torrance Tornado.
For the first half of the race, the punk high school kid was looking at the back of world record holder Don Lash. Then Zamperini pulled up right next to him and stayed there. The two ran stride for stride the final 100 meters. They hit the tape together, tying for first. Louis Zamperini had made the U.S. Olympic team. He was 19 years old. Torrance celebrated its first Olympian. Even the cops were cheering. The boy they thought would wind up in jail was going to Germany instead, to the Berlin Olympics of Jesse Owens and Adolf Hitler. New challenge, new country, new cops.
Louis was the guy who was the fun-loving guy, the rascal. He saw on a flagpole a German flag, the Nazi emblem, the swastika, and he wanted a souvenir for himself. So he shinned up with his pole, maybe 50 feet in height, and slid down into the arms of the Gestapo.
And then I just inadvertently decided to run. Probably the stupidest thing I could have done, but then, of course, I'm a runner. I started to run, and I heard, I believe, a shot. I heard something crack. Then I heard the words, "Haltensee, Haltensee."
This time, the wily runner decided to halt. But Zamperini got to keep that flag. Then he hit the track. In front of 100,000 people, he started the 5,000-meter final, hoping to keep the front runners within safe distance before going for broke. But his lack of experience showed through. With one lap to go, Zamperini was hopelessly behind. Zamperini ran his last lap here in Berlin's Olympic Stadium in a staggering 56 seconds. He finished eighth, ahead of the other Americans, and was congratulated on his closing kick by none other than Adolf Hitler. Zamperini was happy enough with his performance, but saw it as a warm-up. He left Berlin confident that his golden moment was 4 years away at the Tokyo Olympics of 1940, the games which were never held. The Olympics were replaced by a war. Zamperini signed up for bombardier training in Texas. With the rank of second lieutenant, he was posted to Hawaii, where he flew and ran, where he took flak and kept training. Any track would do. Zamperini was taking off. That meant here at Kahuku Air Base. Yep. This was an airbase back then, one of the busiest in the Pacific. On May 26, 1943, Zamperini ran a mile in 4 minutes and 12 seconds here. Hours later, his crew got a call to go out on a rescue mission, and after that, nothing would ever be the same. The only plane available was the Green Hornet, a relic which had been stripped of its parts to service other planes. The pilot, Russell Phillips, was told the Green Hornet had passed inspection. Phillips, Zamperini, and 10 other crew members loaded it up and took off to search for a missing B-25 200 miles north of the island of Palmyra. The Green Hornet headed south to the point where the B-25 had last been heard from, flying at 1,000 feet as the crew scanned the water below for survivors.
As we circled to look for debris in the water, our number one engine, the RPMs dropped. This plane was barely flying with four motors, and with two gone, it just dropped like a rock. The plane exploded. I felt like someone hit me in the forehead with a sledgehammer. My head comes out of the water. It looks just like the world has just stood still for a moment. The plane was completely blown apart, and I could see the pilot, Russell A. Phillips, and McNamara.
Of the crew of 12, only Zamperini, Phillips, and Francis McNamara, the tail gunner, were alive. Zamperini spotted a life raft floating rapidly away from the burning waters. He swam to it, then returned to scoop up Phillips and McNamara.
Yeah, I was glad to see anybody that was moving. And there weren't very many of them.
The tail gunner, within the first half hour, he was screaming, "We're all gonna die, we're all gonna die."
He may have been screaming, but it was not an unrealistic assessment. They were alone in a raft somewhere in the Central Pacific. No one knew they were alive, and it probably didn't make much difference. They seemed destined to disappear without a trace. It was a tiny yellow speck in the Central Pacific. Louis Zamperini and his two comrades, pilot Russell Phillips and tail gunner Francis McNamara, were alive and afloat and aware that they needed a miracle to stay that way very long. Between them, they had 6 bars of chocolate and 6 pints of water.
The first night, and I hate to say this, but the tail gunner panicked, and while we were sleeping, he ate all the chocolate. A ration for 3 of us for a week. So that was all gone.
The water would now be brutally rationed. A sip in the morning, a sip in the evening. But they figured rescue would arrive before the last drop ran out. Sun and sea create delusions.
I felt sure pretty soon somebody's gonna see us, pick us up.
A week passed. No ships, no planes, no rescue, nothing. Day 10. The water was almost gone, but suddenly a plane was spotted overhead.
This was probably the most emotional exhilaration in our lives. I mean, we were actually three grown men. We were crying, tears running down our faces because we knew we'd be rescued. Man, this was great. We'll be eating dinner with the Marines tonight.
The pilot never saw them. There would be no dinner with the Marines.
We went from one extreme to the other, from one extreme of exhilaration to one of fear.
They thought they were alone. That was frightening enough. Terror came when they discovered they were not alone at all.
We were trying to sleep and we felt a big thud in the bottom of the raft. We just froze. We looked out and here we see this great fin going by. And it seemed to be conscious of us, around the raft, slowly, around the raft. And then it would go under the raft and thump it. And we gave orders, do not move, don't say a word. We knew that if he had any sense at all he had to do was just bite through the raft and he had all of us.
After two nights of dread, the shark disappeared back into the deep. Soon, the men were catching small sharks with their bare hands and eating their livers. Meanwhile, Zamperini was cooking up fantasies.
He's always talking about his Italian meal.
And I'd say, well, you know, when I used to cook spaghetti, yeah, well, how do you cook spaghetti? I'd have to go through the whole menu, you know, what you put in, how long you cook it, making biscuits. And it got to the point where this was like we were eating real food, and it got to the point where Mac and Phil would say, well, wait a minute, how much baking powder did you put in?
We'd just keep him going. What came next, you know, what came next?
So I had to cook breakfast for him every morning, I had to cook lunch for him every afternoon, and dinner every evening, and pretty soon they got really selfish and they wanted brunch.
On the 27th day, the hum of another plane engine stirred their hearts.
Took our mirrors and reflected the sun's rays off the plane. And of course, that brought him right over to us.
And then all of a sudden, we heard machine gun firing. I thought, hey, what goes on here? So we looked again. It looked like a B-25, but it had a strange marking on it. It was a red circle.
A red circle, the insignia of the Japanese Imperial Air Force. Zamperini jumped in the water to avoid the strafing. Phillips and McNamara were too weak to tread water, so they stayed in the raft, pretending to be dead.
It's just unbelievable that after 45 minutes of strafing and all those bullet holes, that those guys were missed. It's just a miracle.
It took days to pump out all the water and patch up every hole, but McNamara was sinking fast. On the 33rd night of this odyssey, the tail gunner realized his journey was coming to an end.
And he just asked me the question toward evening. You think I'm going to die? That was it. You think I'm going to die? And I said, yes, I think you're going to die.
He did not see the next break of day. Zamperini gave the eulogy, and then, just after dawn, he and Phillips slipped McNamara overboard. Now there were two men in a raft, as far from salvation as they'd been the day they crashed. 5 weeks had passed.
At 2028 Gramercy Street, Torrance, California, the Zamperinis kept up a vigil for their son, even though they'd received a death certificate signed by President Roosevelt. The Torrance Airfield had already been named after Louis, and all over Southern California, newspapers mourned the death of one of the fastest men the West Coast had ever produced.
I know my mother was sure that he was still alive. My dad took it like the rest of us. We hope for the best.
at the Knights of Columbus track meet at Madison Square Garden, they ran the Louis Zamperini Memorial Mile in his memory. And I broadcast that race, the Louis Zamperini Memorial Mile, and I was crying during the race. I had tears in my eyes and trying to describe the race. Very emotional thing for me.
There were no tears on the raft. There was no water on the raft. It had been 7 days since the last rain.
Because we're ready to die. 7 days without water. The next day, we see the squall coming towards us. It's not squall yet, it's just a cloud, and all of a sudden we look up, and now it's raining. After the all-night storm, we couldn't sleep, and the next morning, just heavy seas like this, and we're lifted up on a wave, and we're looking, like we look every day, we look for land. And so this, I'm lifted high on the wave, and I see an island.
It's not easy to imagine what goes through a man's mind when he sees land after 47 days on a raft. When they washed ashore on this beach, Zamperini and Phillips were so weak they couldn't walk. They had to crawl on the sand. But they were alive. That was the good news. The bad news? They had drifted 2,000 miles all the way to the Marshall Islands, and they were not alone.
The Marshall Islands were a far-flung outpost of the empire ruled from Tokyo, and the welcoming party consisted of Japanese soldiers who dragged the two Americans to their new home. The mood was black in the Marshall Islands that night.
When they first put us in a cell, I just looked down at my knees, the bones and the skin, and I just started crying. Now here I'm an athlete. I remember myself when I was, you know, powerful physical athlete, and now I'm just skin and bone and a skeleton, that's all. And that brought tears to my eyes.
Escape was unthinkable. The Japanese had turned these tropical islands into fortresses, all ready for the Americans they knew would be coming eventually, and not on rafts. Meals were delivered three times a day in the form of a rice ball thrown in the dirt. Water was almost as scarce as it had been on the raft, but there was no shortage of companions.
Well, I felt like there were things running around, there was, and it woke me up. I had this rats sitting right up here on my head.
To Zamperini and Phillips, it was Execution Island. 9 Marines had already been beheaded there, and the Japanese let their new prisoners know their turn would come soon.
They took great joy in telling us we were going to be executed, you know, and they'd always go through the motion, you know, the samurai sword and so forth. And so that was fighting. So every morning we woke up expecting, well, this is the day. This is the day they're going to kill us.
And then the day came, or appeared to. Zamperini and Phillips couldn't see the sun or the trees because they were blindfolded as they were led through the jungle to the officer's courtyard.
Here, at what was the headquarters of the commanding officer, a Japanese doctor was waiting for them, a man who saw them not as fellow human beings or even as Yankee prisoners, but as guinea pigs.
And the doctors and his aides are all standing there, and as they injected us, he says, now, and they had a pad and paper. Tell us every feeling you get, exactly when it happens. And then they started shooting the stuff into our veins. I said, now I feel like needle pricks all over my body. And then they kept letting the stuff go in. I said, now I'm getting dizzy and I'm gonna pass out. And then they stopped.
And then there was news, astonishing news. On their 43rd day of captivity, Zamperini and Phillips were put on a boat heading for Japan. Destination, a POW camp. Zamperini's race against death was just beginning. In September of 1943, Louis Zamperini and Russell Phillips sailed into Tokyo Bay. They were in the belly of the beast.
After 6 months, Phillips was transferred to an officer's camp in the south. Zamperini had hoped to join him, but the Japanese had other plans. Zamperini was shipped to Omori, a camp built on this man-made island in Tokyo Bay. It was here that Louis Zamperini encountered the most frightful figure of his life.
His name was Mutsuhiro Watanabe. He was only a sergeant, but he was clearly in charge.
Every day for 10 days, he punched me out.
This was the kind of a person you'd expect one day to take out his sword and bean you with it, slice you down the middle, you know.
He could fly into a rage so quickly and hit out at people and froth a bit at the mouth, you know, while he was doing it.
Watanabe spoke some English, so the POWs were afraid to call him any of the things which came to mind. The nickname they chose was the bird. Wade drew a picture of the bird.
He had a biggish head, you know, strong face.
I couldn't bear to look in his eyes. I even when I was punished, and he'd say, look in my eyes, I couldn't do it. I just couldn't do it. They were that sadistic.
The Allied prisoners thought the bird was a sadistic psychopath. His Japanese comrades thought he was, well, a sadistic psychopath.
Even among the Japanese, he was disliked. He was hated by all NCO. In Omori, Japanese NCO.
Why?
No question. He was so violent.
In late 1944, Japanese officers brought Zamperini into central Tokyo to Radio Japan, and they made him an offer he really couldn't refuse. Knowing that Zamperini had a lot more star power than Tokyo Rose, they asked him to deliver a radio broadcast to the United States.
I wrote it in such a way that if my parents heard it, that they would know it was me.
On November 18, 1944, Radio Japan announced it had a special guest, Louis Zamperini of 2028 Gramercy Street, Torrance, California.
The courtesy of the authorities here, I am broadcasting this personal message to you. This will be the first time in 2.5 years that you will have heard my voice. I am here.
The broadcast was heard in Torrance. Gramercy Street was stunned. But Lou's brother down in a Navy base didn't hear about it until the next day.
My roommate had been down, picked up a paper, running upstairs, and Pete, he says, Lou's alive.
A few months later, officers approached Zamperini about making another broadcast, except this time, Japanese hands would write the script. Zamperini refused. His captors threatened to send him to a special punishment camp.
My first thought was, anything is better than going back to the bird. If I get away from him, I don't care where I go.
53 years ago this week, Zamperini and 8 other prisoners were put on a steam train and sent north. They didn't know where they were going, but at least they were getting away from the clutches of the bird.
And we see these beautiful snow-covered Alp-type mountains. We went right through Nagano and then went on to Noetsu.
When we arrived, we couldn't believe it. We got out of the station, and there was a big exit round gate from the station. It was full up with snow to the rooftop. Oh, where the hell? How do you walk through this stuff?
The prisoners had arrived at Nawetsu, a cold, forbidding place on the Sea of Japan, just 40 minutes outside Nagano. They were taken to a camp at the confluence of two rivers and ordered to stand at attention.
We just stood there at attention, stood there, probably 10 or 15 minutes. You know, and all of a sudden the door opens up, and out stepped the bird.
If someone had given me a pistol, then I would have just blown my brains out.
I felt probably the lowest ebb of my life. I just felt, you know, almost like it's useless.
The bestial treatment and brutal weather had already killed 60 Australian prisoners. With Japan slowly starving in 1945, there was hardly any food for the POWs. And now with the bird in command, Zamperini was entering the final stretch of his long marathon. If ever the kid with the fast finish needed a closing kick, he needed it now.
One day in April, the bird ordered Zamperini to look after a sickly goat.
He said, if the goat dies, you die. Told everybody in camp, the goat dies, he dies. And the goat died.
And instead of some usual kind of punishment, he said, pick up that piece of wood. He pointed to a 4x4x6 feet and made Sam hold it above his head and just hold it there and said, wait. And then he went and sat on the roof of a little adjoining building, very low roof, you know, sat on there in the sunshine, talking to friends, you know, great fun.
For the first 3 minutes, I could hardly take it. Then I kind of went numb. And I was just frozen in that position.
And he was in agony, every muscle strained, his neck, his eyes, his head, his face.
Zamperini, all 90 pounds of him, wouldn't give in. Finally, driven berserk by the American's resilience, the bird came down from the roof and punched him in the stomach. Zamperini collapsed, the 4x4 on top of him. Wade noted the time. Zamperini had been holding that plank for 37 minutes.
As the summer of 1945 swung around, the prisoners knew it would be their last summer, and not necessarily because the Americans were winning the war.
Unless we had a crop that we could have reaped, or if our banditry didn't improve, we would have been dead. That's all there was to it.
At the end of that summer of 45, the Japanese told the prisoners to write the letters POW on top of the warehouse. And there was more. They were taken down to this river for the first time to take a bath. They'd barely gotten their feet wet when an American plane appeared overhead, blinking its red light, sending a message in Morse code. The message was, the war is over.
You're well over with emotion and excitement. It's just so much so you feel it's going to explode your body to get out.
The Zamperini family waited for their long-lost son in Long Beach, California, which is not far from Hollywood, and happy endings.
When I saw them and ran up to my parents and my family, I just felt that I'd come back alive. You know, that I'd been dead and I came back alive.
Probably the biggest thrill my folks had ever had. And the caresses and embracing, kissing and the hugging, it was just fantastic. He just came alive with it, just came alive. As a matter of fact, I feel it now.
Louis hopped right into the fast lane, trying to catch up with the time he had lost. In 1947, he met Miami debutante Cynthia Applewhite and married her 6 months later. The pace was furious, but he couldn't go the distance. Louis Zamperini could not outrun his past.
Every night, the bird came into my nightmares. No matter what other nightmares I had, he was always in my nightmares. And I was always strangling him with my hands around his throat. He was beating me in prison camp. All I wanted was revenge. When I came home from the war, I thought, if I ever make any money, I'm going to go back to Japan, I'm going to look him up, and I'm going to finish him off.
But the only guy Zamperini was finishing off was himself. He was drinking heavily, taking a dive. His wife urged him to go listen to a young preacher named Billy Graham. One sermon did the trick, Zamperini decided to serve the Lord. How? Go to Japan, spread the word, and face the ghosts.
I was mad because I was going back to Japan, yet I was thrilled because I was in God's will. So I had those two, the mixed feelings.
At Sugamo Prison, he confronted many of his old guards and confounded them with absolution.
The most important thing in my Christian life was to know that I not only forgave them verbally, but to see them face to face and tell them that I forgave them.
But if Zamperini was finding the answers he needed to go on living, there remained one haunting question.
My only disappointment was when they said, well, where is the bird? I thought he'd be there.
Zamperini wasn't the only one asking that question. Among other men looking for the bird was one General Douglas MacArthur. In 1945, he drew up a list of the 40 most wanted war criminals in Japan. Number 23, Mutsuhiro Watanabe, alias the bird. MacArthur never found him, neither did anyone else. Right after the war, the bird flew up to these mountains right above Nagano. He hid out here for 7 years. Zamperini thought he was dead. His mother thought he was dead. She built a shrine for him. But the bird wasn't dead, and he isn't. This is Mutsuhiro Watanabe, and this is the first televised interview of his life.
Beetle, Kikun, Chinua, Hakujin Shakan Oitewa, Shiona.
Zamperini and the other prisoners remember you in particular as being the most brutal of all the guards. How do you explain that?
ミリタリーオーダーでやったというわけではなくて、やはり私自身の気持ちから見てフレンドにはならなかったですね。ザンパリニさんは有名な人だし、あったんだし、彼が渡辺に殴られたというならば、キャンプ内でそういう事実が
But Japan didn't remain an enemy of the United States very long, and in 1952, all charges against the bird were quietly dropped. The man who made so many lives so miserable sold life insurance after the war, became wealthy. Zamperini came back to Japan a few weeks ago, wanted to meet the bird, but the bird did not want to meet him. So, Zamperini found another track to his past. There wasn't much question as to who would carry the torch through Nawetsu, the city which was once his prison. Louis Zamperini had no competition. Who could possibly compete with that smile? The 81-year-old ran for a kilometer, didn't set any records, didn't need to. He set those a long time ago.
Extremely emotional for me to know that there were that kind of people here that would erect such a memorial to prisoners of war. And when I think back to 1945 and when we left Nawetsu,
it was such a horrible place in our minds, I couldn't look back. But when I leave here today, believe me, I will look back and I will never forget.
We're joined now by 81-year-old Louis Zamperini. And when we come back, we'll talk with him as he reflects on his remarkable journey. And we continue from Nagano right after this.
The 18th Olympic Winter Games on CBS.
Welcome back. The closing ceremony is coming up shortly. Louis Zamperini joins us. And after watching that incredible story, it's hard to believe that it's not fictional. What does it mean to you to be here tonight at this closing ceremony in Japan?
Well, it means an awful lot to me because I've never been honored at a Winter Olympic Games. I'm a Summer Olympian.
You are a Summer Olympian. And here, as a Winter Olympian, you got to carry the torch during the relay. What did that mean to you?
Well, carrying the torch meant a lot to me because I believe the torch does play a large part in the Olympics. I mean, it points to and I believe focuses the world's attention on the Olympics.
Your story was really documented in all the Japanese newspapers. What's been the reaction you've had here from all the people?
Well, I've had a tremendous reaction from the Japanese people, especially the people at Noetsu, where I started the torch. And their graciousness and their compassion and love, it was unbelievable. It more than compensated for my past years in Japan about 53 years ago.
Mm. And that's only about 40 minutes from this stadium where we sit tonight. It's hard to believe that years later, that a half century later, you would come back and experience something like that. Does it boggle your mind when you think about that?
Really, I've never gotten it over yet, and I probably never will.
Now, attempts were made for you to meet with Watanabe, with the bird. What would you have said had you spoken to him?
Well, I wanted to meet with him, and he wanted to meet with me. And then he changed his mind, and I think because he felt that I might expect some kind of, bowing and asking forgiveness, but that was furthest from my mind. I just wanted to talk to him about his life, his family life, and things in general, to kind of smooth things over and maybe add a little salve to the wound, you know.
Granting forgiveness, though, is really your message, isn't it? Is that what you would have done to him? Would you have done that?
I came back to Japan in 1950. I was allowed to speak to the Tsuyama prison, all the war criminals, and I expected him to be there. But they said they thought he had committed harakiri. And that kind of made me sad. I really wanted to face him and tell him right to his face that I forgave him.
People want to know, what have you been doing with your life? What happened after 1950 when you came here?
Well, in 1949, I was converted under Billy Graham, and that's the reason I was able to go back to Japan, completely and totally with an open heart and say, I forgive you. Since then, I've been working with youth, problem kids, kids from broken families, in a High Sierra, kind of an outward bound program, teaching skiing, mountaineering, survival, rescue, and things like that.
And you still do that today?
You bet.
Do you believe in the Olympic spirit?
I believe in the Olympic spirit. In fact, I believe the Olympic spirit is like the wind. You don't see it coming and you don't see it going, but you hear its voice. And you feel the power of its presence, and you see the results of its passing, and then it becomes memories. You might say an aura of days of glory.
Well, I think the whole nation enjoyed hearing your powerful message tonight and your story. It certainly rings out to everyone. Thank you, Mr. Zamperini.
Thank you very much, Jim.
We appreciate you sharing that story with us very, very much. The closing ceremony of the 18th Olympic Winter Games will begin shortly. We'll have it for you and much more when we continue from Nagano right after this.
So does that put into perspective the definition of what's a bad day in your life? I don't know how many times I've seen it, but moves me every time, just as much this time as the first time. That's great. Let's welcome a true American hero, Louis Zamperini. So Louis, as you heard, is the only person to have carried the torch five different times, five cities, was nice enough to bring tonight the torch from the 1984 Los Angeles Summer Olympics. I'm going to pass it around. I'm going to tell you, if I see anybody heading up the aisle, heading out with this, we've got a lot of good athletes around here, so we'll be right after you. You can just pass it along, Steve. Louis, welcome.
That was, I lit that a couple of days ago.
Louis always says that, hey, I wouldn't mind lighting it in here if you want, but I have a feeling
I use lighter fluid than I light it, and I'm just, people go crazy over the flame.
Right. So how does it make you feel when you come back to campus when you're here?
This is my favorite spot right here. Yeah. Yeah, on the track, of course. Yeah, just, I have five torches. That's a world record. John Neighbors got four, but they would let him run in Japan, so I was the only American to carry the torch there. And the funny thing is that the mayor had sent me an email and said, when you come to carry the torch in Japan, we will line the streets and cheer you on. I think you noticed the kids were tight together. There was no place to stand. It was just beautiful. But then the mayor, the next morning, he wanted me to come before the city council to answer questions. And so I did, and they were asking some very formal questions. And the mayor, he said, tell me, Mr. Zamperini, did anything good come out of your being a prisoner of war for 2.5 years in Japan? I said, yeah, it prepared me for 55 years of married life. I didn't know they had a video on that. When I got back home, I went to New York, and my wife got the video.
So tell us about how your life has changed since the book came out. And we always knew when it came out, your life would change.
Well, during this book?
Yes.
Well, everything's going crazy. I mean, this book here started everything. Then London got the rights to Europe, and then their book came out and it has a different cover, but beautiful. I mean, it's thicker for some reason. And then last week, a French book came out on my old book, which is Devil at My Heels. But you know what they call it? The devil is my, no, death is my companion. Death is my companion. That's the name of the book. Well, that's not my companion. and now I think there's four different countries that published the old book, and one published the new book, England, because they have the rights to Europe. And so just started things just going crazy, and I just get a lot of mail, a lot of phone calls, and I'm not sure I like it. I'd like to get out in the wilderness and get away from it all. But because Seabiscuit, that she wrote years ago, made Universal $250 million profit. And so when this book hit number one, they grabbed it quick and she sold it to them. But she's a real faithful friend, even though she's ill. She's been in bed now for 2 months. She's got the worst case of chronic fatigue syndrome and vertigo, it's in the brain. And so the book is hers. She did the research on it, which was no writer in the world would do what she did. She spent years and years checking everything. Everything I say, she loves me, she trusts me, she knows I don't lie, but she still checks on me. And I said, don't go back into my childhood too much on your research. But like, for instance, okay, the day before I was picked up Woji Island, we were on a big swell, we saw an island, and then a storm hit us. And I said the waves were 25 to 45 feet high, and they were. But when I got home, the meteorologist said they don't have storms like that on near the equator. And she got on her computer, it took her a week to do all the weather patterns all over the Pacific. She called me and says, you know what you were in? You were in an unusual typhoon. So she confirmed it, made me feel like, you know, hey, was I exaggerating or dreaming or what? But it was true, and that went on to China and hit China. But that's the way she is. She, if you don't believe what she says, you just look in the back of the book, and her contact she made on the computer, everything has to be 100% truth.
You shared with me when I was at your home last a couple of the letters that you'd received from people. There was a woman from in the South, I think from Alabama, that had talked about how her life had changed since she read the book. Are you getting letters like that just kind of constantly?
Yeah, I get just a flood of letters from people that are benefited when they realize what you went through and you overcome an adversity. Some of them, they don't try to overcome the adversity. They just stop right there, and it just eats on them. And so when I sign a book, I always sign it their name, and I put B. Hardy, because our generation, I don't like the term the greatest generation. Tom Brokaw sent me a book last week and says, I don't know how I missed you. I'm not in his book. But I like the term Hardy, because every time you overcome an adversity, you become more hardy. And that was our period of time before World War II. We had nothing but adversity. We had to overcome it. We also had to forage for food. We'd run out of money 2 days before payday. We'd have to go out and shoot a rabbit and have rabbit cacciatore. And that's good, by the way. And then my mother would say, well, we're out of money. 2 days before payday, go down to the beach and bring us home some abalone. Well, water up your knees, tire iron. At that time, that was poor man's food. Now it's $100 a pound. And then we had wild tomatoes and wild radishes growing up on Palo Verde's hill. Then we had a slough out there where the big sports center is now, in Carson, mm-hmm. year-round water. And the ducks would stop there on the way south and, you know, go home, bring the duck home. We'd go out there and shoot a duck. Sometimes the ducks weren't there. They had mud hens. You know what a mud hen is? Nobody eats a mud hen. But mud hen cacciatore isn't bad.
You know, you told me last week that other than, you know, maybe a little cold here and there, basically you haven't been sick, haven't been really ill in 20-some-odd years.
Nothing. 25 years, I have nothing.
Nope. And I loved what
not
you
even
said
a sniffle, huh?
About if you, because you spent your whole life really, since you got back from the war, doing good, and you said if you do good, you feel good.
Yeah, that's the important thing is, the famous John Muir, he says, go climb a mountain and get their glad tidings and your cares will drop like autumn leaves. Well, the glad tidings he got was endorphins. And I didn't know what it was in those days, but endorphins is sort of like corpuscles invading your immune system. And then when you do good, I was up on the ridge route many years ago, and a couple there standing outside their car, nobody stopping. I stopped. Oh, we're out of gas. Well, I keep 2 gallons in my car for my trail bikes. I poured it in their tank. He pulled out a wad of money. I said, nope, just thank God I stopped. I got in my car, looked back, and there he was. He couldn't believe it. Boy, did I feel good. Well, when you feel good, that's a chemical, or it's the white corpuscles invading your immune system. And whenever I go to the hospital for something, I heal a week early. And the doctors always say, boy, you've got a powerful immune system. But to have that, you have to be positive all the time. You can't let anything get you down. Whatever happens, even broken hip I had, you have to accept it as all things work together for good. And if you do that, you'll get over it quicker. Yeah, I had a dolly that fell apart, went down a stairway with about 100 pounds of cement, threw me forward. I went down 4 feet to the ground on my hip. That was just a few years ago. And man, I laid there, my neighbors are not home, it's dark, and I got 3 rooms to go through and 2 stairways. And I knew I shattered everything on my hip. And man, I said, Lord, I know everything works together for good. This better be good. And I finally worked my fanny up the first stairway, then through a room, another stairway, and 2 more rooms to the phone, called my daughter, they took me to the hospital. And when I got there, I have to be cheerful, have a cheerful countenance at all times, and that's where your health comes from. So anyway, my son came to visit me, and this one nurse, black nurse, she said, oh, I just love your daddy, he makes me feel so good. Well, that's humor. And then this tall blonde walks in, and she saw my SC hat, and she said, oh, I'm a Trojan, a big tall nurse. And so we talked football and other things, and then she said, well, Louis, I came in to give you a shot. She gave me a shot, talked for another minute or two, and she says, well, Louis, I got to leave you now. I said, no woman ever said that to me. Well, that's my stay in the hospital, humor. And so I got out a week early. The doctor said, yeah, man, you healed a week early. She brought 8 other nurses up to meet me. So, you know, be cheerful. Have a cheerful countenance at all times. When I left the hospital, they came down and had their pictures taken. And I had one nurse, I'm sitting on my knees, and I'm just getting over a broken hip. And then, by the way, they all went out and bought the old book, Devil at My Heels. So, you know, it was great. And so if you're cheerful, if you have that cheerful countenance, you'll get white corpuscles flooding your immune system, you'll heal quicker. And I honestly haven't had any kind of slightest inkling of a cold or flu or anything.
How did you stay positive? How did you keep that positive attitude you talk about during your ordeal?
Well, it's part of the same situation. First of all, on the life raft, I was positive about everything. Why? Because I took survival courses. I took Dr. Webster.
Here at USC.
Yeah, he said, your brain is like a muscle. If you don't use it, it will atrophy. So on the raft, I had something going every day, memorizing things, cooking meals. And we did that every day. Now, the other two didn't know this, but I knew all the hit parade songs. I teach them the words. The pilot, the father was a minister, he taught us the words of the songs. We reminisced, we planned ahead. And after 47 days, our minds were sharper than the day we crashed. But think of it this way, in the world, when you watch television every day, I don't think you've heard any good news recently. All these riots and all this stuff on TV, all this swearing and pornography and all that. And if our brains are fed that every day. Okay, you crash in a plane, and now you leave this confused world and chaotic world, and a whole new world starts. So everything we put in our brain from then on was positive. You hear a fish hit the water and you flash, you hear that noise, you hear a bird chirping, the wind blowing, and then we fed our brains what we wanted to feed it. And now the tail gunner panicked the first half hour. As we got in the raft, he just said, we're going to die, we're all going to die. And I tried to settle him down, nothing worked. And you know what I did, I had to crack him across the face. A week later, he did the same thing, and I thought, boy, if anybody hallucinates, he will. He died on the 33rd day, and he was a different person. He was sharper than the day he started. And so when we were picked up, the proof of that is that we were able to defeat five highly skilled interrogation officers in the Japanese Navy. There was not one thing that they got out of us, and yet we had them satisfied. And now, so actually, after 47 days, our minds were sharper than the day we started. Now, that panel of six officers, they had a tablecloth, soda pop, biscuits, cookies. They wouldn't give us any unless we answered their question the way they wanted. And so we went back to our cells without any treats. Now, out of those six officers, one of them said, "Lieutenant Zamperini, when you were entering USC in 1936, I was graduating." I said, and this guy, out of the six, he was the most obnoxious. I couldn't believe this guy was a Trojan. We believe in excellency in sports. We believe in excellency in education. We believe in excellency in morale. And this guy's a creep. But I finally found the answer. He had to be a third-year transfer from UCLA.
Louis, what would you say was most challenging? Was it the time you spent in those 47 days in the raft, or the time in the prison under the threat of execution all the time?
Well, the most... on the raft, there's too many things happened that were brutal. Getting machine gunned for a half hour, that was beyond our comprehension. We're in a space that big, three of us, and in that space there's 48 bullet holes and nobody's touched. We're missed about an eighth of an inch, quarter inch. It's just, when you talk about a miracle, that had to be a miracle.
How were you able to patch the boat?
That was a problem. See, if you take an inner tube and put it in a pool and shoot it full of holes, it won't sink. It'll still stay up. So the life raft is flat in the water. And three of us in it, yes, it's flat in the water. Water's over the top. Then we got the pump out and we start pumping. Of course, bubbles came up all over, but we had to pump around the clock. That was a killer. And then when the sun came out, we could dry the rubber, we put patches on. And that was really brutal, trying to patch that raft with that many holes. And now, when the tube in the raft, when the bullet goes to the top, it makes a hole in the bottom.
Right.
So we patched the top first, but when we pump, we got bubbles coming up.
And you're treading water this whole time and so weak from not having so little food.
Yeah, absolutely. And then in order to patch, now the raft is in two sections. You got two units. We opened up one unit, put the pump in it, pumped that one up, and then the tail gunner had to sit there and pump it up with one hand, and then he had an aluminum oar because we had to let the air out of one half of the raft, and then one guy pulls it up. When it's dry, we try to put a patch on. So they had a patch kit, like a bicycle kit, and you have sandpaper to rough up the rubber. So that was the mistake they made. They put sandpaper in there for that purpose, but the sand came off of the paper. Now, they should have used a waterproof or a memory cloth, and that would have done it. So I took the mirror, and I made three teeth marks on the mirror so I could scratch the rubber so that the patch would stick. Now, he holds the raft up. The tail gunner's keeping the shocks from the nippiness in the rear. And just as it dries, we get ready to put the dope on, the white cap hits it. So it was brutal. All day long, we put on about three or four patches. But after about 10 days, we got it in pretty good shape to where we only had to pump it up about once every 15 minutes. Otherwise, we were pumping up constantly. That was a horrible ordeal, and then of course the strafing was a horrible ordeal, and then that great white that hit us on the bottom and lifted us in the air, and that was frightening. But the most frightening thing of all was that day before we landed, that storm that hit us, 25, 45 foot waves. I'll tell you, I've been scared a few times in my life, but there's nothing worse than an angry sea.
Yeah, yeah. But you never lost hope.
No, hope, to me, hope is the power of the soul to endure, and hope must have a reason. Faith is a substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So faith must have an object. So our hope was changed to faith the day the plane came over, because they copied our B-25. We knew the airspeed, gas consumption. They took off at 7 in the morning, and they had a half hour to kill over the target. Now they're running out of fuel, they went back. So we were able to make a simple calculation. So now we got an object. We saw the plane, and the thing that we don't see, the invisible thing, would be the islands, mm-hmm. the Marshall Islands. And so I picked the 47th day we'd land, and my pilot picked the 46th day. And we saw the land on the 46th day and landed on the 47th. So hope is one thing and faith is another.
Yeah. Now you still drive, not as much, but you still occasionally will make your way.
Your coordination doesn't change.
Yeah.
I can avoid a lot of women drivers, no problem.
Well, I wanted to ask you.
I still fly airplanes, hell.
Yeah. I wanted to ask, because you are on the freeway occasionally, and you continue to do good. You still believe that you can do good even when you're driving. And I know you've told me about examples of doing good on the freeway.
Yeah, I got doing good and never get mad. I got it licked. Except on the freeway. On the freeway, people are so rotten on the freeway. It won't give an inch. And I said, I got to lick this. This is part of the hardiness to overcome. Anything you overcome, you become more hardy. So in traffic in the city, yeah, I'm very kind. I move out of the way. You can make a turn. People thank you, and that's great. Sometimes they don't thank you. They say, well, I had the right of way, and they go along. And about a year ago, I had this woman there in Hollywood near Cherimoya, and she was caught in a jam. And I maneuvered out of the way and let her go by. And she just drove away. And I said, well, that's her problem. But she had a sunroof. She reached up and waved back at me. And then I had another woman throw me a kiss. I let her go by. So, you know, if you try to be a decent driver and courteous in traffic, it might pick up. The other person might pick it up. And but as I say, the freeway is the final test. There are things people do, tailgating and get in your way. And I like to drive in the slow lane, relax, put my music on. And that's part of longevity, because if you want to age fast, the greatest stress you can be under is on the freeway. And so I tell people, just leave early, get in the slow lane, and put some music on, and enjoy driving. And you can enjoy it. But you see people going like that, they're under the worst stress of all. So it's a good idea to, if you can lick that on the freeway, you got it licked forever.
So how do you keep stress out of your life?
Well, out in the evenings, tonight, of course, I won't do it. Every night I have a fire, and I put on meditation music, classicals, Bach, and Beethoven, and I listen to an hour of music while I'm sitting in front of my fireplace. And then I get my dinner, and so it's a time to relax. And if you don't have a period of relaxing, I mean total, complete relaxing, some people are under stress all day long. They're under stress at home. They're under stress when they're sleeping.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the killer.
So can you keep stress out of your life even if you're a student taking classes and, you know, your extracurricular activities or anything else?
Well, you're naturally under stress when you're taking classes, and especially when you haven't studied for the class. But yeah, when you're going to school, yeah, you're under stress, there's no question about it, because you have to pass, you have to get your grades in, get your degree, but you can still be relaxed in the meantime. You can make up for it by being extra relaxed, like when I go home and listen to my music, or take a drive, leave early. You can really relax in traffic if you leave early, have plenty of time, and sit there and just absorb the music.
But you've also told me in the past that part of the key to keeping stress out is never allowing it in the first place.
Yeah, I was, the VA had put out a notice that if you were a prisoner of war, you would get some kind of an added compensation. And well, I didn't apply for it, I didn't need it, but the American Legion called me and said, well, you haven't applied for your compensation. So I said, okay, so I went out to the VA at Sawtelle, and I had to sign a paper, but they put me to work. I had to go through all kinds of physicals, 5 days in a row. And then finally I said, well, I hope it's all over. And the girl said, no, you've got to go see the psychiatrist now. And she said, it's 5 o'clock, she's probably leaving. So she called her and she was leaving. She said, well, he came a long ways. Couldn't you just see him for a minute or two? And she said, well, okay, send him in. So she was the psychiatrist, but she was uptight. So I went in there and she said, well, sit down. And I sat down, she says, well, first of all, how do you deal with your anxieties and stress? And I said, well, I don't have any anxieties. She said, what do you mean everybody does? We tell movie stars that they're under pressure all week long. We tell them to go into a dark closet, close the door and just scream for about a minute or two and let it all out. I said, well, I don't have to let it out. She said, what do you mean? I said, I don't let it in. She said, well, everybody's confronted with anxiety. I know, but when anxiety knocks at my door, I don't open the door. I said, return good for evil. What am I letting in? Do good to them that hate you. What am I letting in? So and she was dumbfounded. She kept me there for 45 minutes. And finally she said, when I left, she said, well, I learned something today. No, you don't have to let the anxiety in. Mm-hmm. And so I don't, and I think that's part of my my health for my age, and not being sick for 25 years, that's something. So that's the secret.
You're okay with not skiing anymore?
What's that?
You're okay with not skiing anymore, snow skiing?
Well, I quit skateboarding on my 81st birthday. The traffic stopped on Gower Street. But you know, when I went down the street, there was a kid there who was a state champion skateboarder. And he saw me make a run down the street for a block and turn the corner. Total stranger, he came up to me and gave me a big hug. I said, what's that? He says, well, I'm the state champion skateboarder. So, but I thought, well, stopping traffic, I guess I'm old enough to stop. So I quit skateboarding. Now the thing is, I had a brand new super skateboard. The Clifton Cafeteria, the owner bought me the skateboard for my birthday. And some teenager stole it. And they were gonna call the sheriff. I said, no, no, what a headline that would be. Teenager steals senior citizen skateboard. So then I kept on skiing, and so when I'm 94 now, but 91 I was gonna, I went with my daughter skiing at Mountain High, and I still had, you know, parallel skiing, and I still do my tricks on skis, not as well as I did. But then a snowboarder came down, he had to be doing 50 miles an hour. Now skiing is an art. Snowboarding is one turn or the other, but skiing you can do about 18 to 20 different things, and so you love to make these carving turns. When I turn, I looked up, there's no snowboarder. I made a turn, there he is. They go so fast, my daughter screamed. She said, Dad, if he'd hit you, you'd have been dead. So then I decided to quit. So yeah. I've had my years of skiing. I've skied everything. I've skied glaciers all over New Zealand. And so I've had my fun.
You had a good run.
Yeah.
My friend Steve, we were talking the other day, and he read the book, and he was very moved by the book. And he said, I said, any questions that pop out in your head about Louis' life? And he said, I'm curious about what was the one, when you hit rock bottom after you came back over, and your wife dragged you off to see Billy Graham. It's two times, not once, back again. What was the one thing that was said then that made you finally decide to change your life?
Well, you see, this post-traumatic stress, it doesn't start after the war, it starts during the war. When the bird's on me every day, I had nightmares then. I'd go to bed in the barracks on a wooden floor, and you're covered with hundreds and hundreds of insects. You wake up in the morning, your body's a welt. And I'm always strangling him in my nightmares in prison and on the way home. And my wife didn't know it when I asked her to marry me. We got married, and this post-traumatic stress got more and more serious, and it got worse. And I'm always strangling the guy, and I wake up in a cold sweat, and so I woke up with my hands around my wife's throat, and that scared me to death. And so then some young guy in the apartment where we were, he came to us and said, oh, there's a young evangelist coming to Hollywood next week, or L.A., and he started quoting scripture to us. I just walked out. My wife listened. And so he and his girlfriend took my wife down. In the meantime, I was out every night getting drunk with a couple of other Olympian buddies. And so when you got three Olympians together in a bar, you don't buy a drink.
Right.
And so she came home. She had already filed for a divorce. And I loved my wife. This was breaking my heart, but I couldn't quit drinking. And so finally she went to the meeting with this couple, and she came home and told me about her new life in Christ. And so she started to try to get me down there, and I just wasn't having any part of it. But then she said something that softened me up. She says, because of my conversion, I'm not going to get a divorce. Well, boy, that was a relief. But then I still wouldn't go down. But she finally, that did soften me up, and I did go down under conditions. And Billy Graham is preaching, and I thought, I don't need him to tell me I'm a sinner, I know I am. So I grabbed her and pulled her on home, and the next day she's all over me again, because she knew this is the only thing that's going to save our marriage. And so after about 2 hours of bitter argument, I said, okay, I'll go back, but when that guy says every head bowed and every eye closed, we're out of there. And so I went back there, but he said something that struck me really hard, and that was that when people come to the end of their rope and there's nowhere else to turn, no matter who you are, you always turn to God. And I thought, that's what we did on the raft. We did that in prison camp. And on Kwajalein Island, thousands of prayers, God, save me through all this. Get me home alive to my family, and I'll seek you and serve you. And then I realized what a heel I was. I came home alive, never even thought about the promises. So instead of leaving the tent, I went back to the prayer room and made a confession of my faith in Christ, and I couldn't believe what was happening while I was still on my knees. I knew positively I'm still drinking. I knew positively I forgave all my guards, including the bird. And that was something.
Yeah, yeah.
I couldn't believe what was happening. I went home and took all the wine and liquor I had and just poured it down the drain, and that was it.
Mm-hmm.
And so and my life has been, you might say, a bed of roses ever since.
So you went from wanting to strangle the bird to completely forgiving him. If you'd had a chance to meet him, it would have been just all about forgiveness.
And that's a big response from the book. I got so many letters from men and women both that had this vendetta hate. Well, and that's what puts you under stress. If you hate somebody, it's like a boomerang that misses the target, comes back and hits you. And I had a girl at Rolling Hills Day School. After I left the school, I told the class, if you want to really age quick, hate somebody. That'll age you quick. A week later, I got a letter, and this girl said, after you left the school, I went to a girl that I've hated for 2 years, and I asked her to forgive me, and now we're the best of friends. Well, just about a month or two ago, I talked to the teacher, and they're still very close friends. So hate shouldn't have any part in our life, no yeah. kind of hate.
Yeah. Let's get some questions. Anybody that feel free to step up to the mic. We're doing that so that we can record this and make sure that the sound is clear, the recording. So just step up and ask Louis any questions you might have. Come on, you guys. One of the two mics.
You want to ask me if I run? Yeah, I run 5 yards.
Yeah, Jeff, here, yeah, one of our visitors tonight.
Mr. Zamperini, I have a question about something I read in the book that really startled. Can you hear me okay?
I'll help.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's a part at the end of the book when the war is winding down, and it's now in August, and I guess there's a sense you didn't know what was happening, but the atomic bomb was being dropped on Hiroshima. And it really struck me because all through college and high school, we were always like writing papers and stuff of like the morality of the atomic bomb. Was it right? Was it wrong? And when I read it in your book, it was the first time I actually thought, wow, what did this guy really think? Because at least the sense I got from the book was that you all believed that it hastened the end of the war and it might have been the right thing to do. But I guess what I'm asking is now in the 50 years since, what's your sense of the rightness or the wrongness of the atomic bomb and dropping it on Japan?
So looking back 50 years later when the atomic bomb, at the time you might have thought it was the right thing to do, upon reflection 50 years later, what's your thought about our decision to do that?
Well, to me there's no question about it. People that knew what the consequences would be if the bomb hadn't been dropped. An officer, when I talked to this officer in Japan, he said if there had been an invasion, at least 10% of the Japanese would die, and they had 70 million. The women were, and the girls were given augers, and they were told that when the Americans land, they will rape you and kill you, so you take your auger out and stab them. They still had a couple of thousand kamikaze planes, but And then the field marshal gave the orders that if there is an attempted invasion, before the invasion, they had to kill all the POWs, and there were 90 camps. And then they had, what people don't know, was at that time they were training high school kids and college kids, and they're 15, 16, and 17. They were giving them about a month's training, and they were to be the main part of the invasion. And with that kind of training, they'd have been slaughtered. And so when there was questions about the atomic bomb, a number of those guys who are businessmen now and lawyers had written in and said, we were part of the youth corps and we would have been the invading army of Japan. So as far as death were concerned, death is death no matter what the battlefield. And Hiroshima, the death rate there was lower than the firebombing of Tokyo. Mm-hmm. It's just that the frightening fact that something like the atomic bomb had come by, it's hard to accept.
Sure.
And we heard it in prison camp. They got the magazine and we thought, what's this? So it's frightening, and it's still frightening. And I'm against nuclear fission of any kind. Mm-hmm. Because you got all of this nuclear waste, now they can't find places to dump it. So the world's contaminated with that. But we feel strongly that Truman made the right decision because of the lives that were saved. Now, I went to Hiroshima in 1950, and I have a rifle hit by the atomic bomb, roofing tile. I was a guest of the mayor. I went to the hospital, and I talked to every single burnt victim. It took me 2 weeks. Took pictures of them, burnt backs, and they all said, in essence, I feel honored this happened to me, that millions of lives were saved. They knew that millions of people were saved as a result of the bomb. Now, regular bombing, we don't think much about it, but atomic bomb, that's frightening. And so I think that's what caused people to resent the bomb. But when you consider the lives, they now also they don't know that at Hiroshima we had a prison camp there, and there were B-24 crew members, and almost all of them were burned in the bomb. You don't hear about that, but we got the names of them, pictures, and so forth.
Yeah.
Now it's a question of numbers, and the youth corps would have been about 250,000 to 500,000 young kids, 16, 17, 18. And they would have been sent there for the invasion.
Go ahead. Yep.
Hi. I was wondering, since you returned home, how did your friendship or relationship with the other man, Russ Phillips, who went through the whole ordeal with you, kind of develop over the rest of the course of your life? Did you remain close?
Or? It's about your friendship with Russell Phillips. How did that develop after you came home? Did you stay close? How relationship you had?
Oh, yeah. In Hollywood, everything was free. So he came out, Fred Garrett, the one that lost a leg, pilot. I went to the Florentine Gardens, big dinner, all I had to get up and speak for 5 minutes, and everything was paid for. And the same with Earl Curls. Now, people don't realize that was the number one spot in the world on Sunset Boulevard. And they had a big sign up there, through these portals past the most beautiful girls in the world. That was the spot where people came from all over the world to see Earl Curls. But you kids are too young to have heard of that. But the building is still there. And I was there to get an award along with Gregory Peck. I ran against him in the half mile in college. And so he and I were buddies, and we were to be introduced by Sammy Davis Jr., part of the Pack Rat.
The Rat Pack.
And and he kept yakking and singing. And Gregory Peck, he sent me a bottle of champagne at my table. And then his card said, Gregory Peck, and I turned it over and it says, I'll race you around the block. Yeah, after an 8-course dinner and a bottle of champagne,
right.
I'm going to run around the block.
Right.
But that was part of the life. So then when Phillips came out to visit me, and Fred Garrett with one leg off, he had a prosthetic leg. So we went to Florentine Gardens and danced, and we'd go to Earl Curls dinner, and everything was on the house. No, we were close friends. During the war, I had a fantastic crew. Each guy was unique. Each guy had a different personality, and God, I just loved those guys. The navigator's father was a professor at Northwestern. The co-pilot was a stocky, rugged guy with a cigar, but as timid as a baby. And I liked my classical music, and I had a stack of it, my record player in the barracks. And he thought he'd throw a left hook at me, so he went out and bought a little record like that and gave it to me for Christmas. He thought it would be an insult, but I loved it. And it was called The Owl and the Pussycat. Remember that one, the English? The owl and the pussycat went out to sea in a beautiful pea green boat with plenty of honey and money wrapped up in a 5-pound note. That, and he got an awful discouragement with it. I kept playing it over and over again. But no, there's something about war buddies. I don't know what it is, but there's a camaraderie that you can't match anywhere. The kid last month that came back and had his foot, had a prophetic leg put on. I said, what are you going to do now? He said, I'm going to go back to Afghanistan. Why? I want to be with my buddies. There's a camaraderie there that's hard to explain, but and those guys, I miss them. Now, the way Laura wrote her book, I couldn't read it all. I had to read one chapter a day because her book puts you in prison. You feel like we felt. And I'd have to look out the window to be sure I was home. So it took me a long time to read the book in that respect. But then, and she apologized. I said, but you made up for it because you brought my 4 dead buddies, or the 3 of them, you brought them back to life. And momentarily I was just thrilled to death. And I could actually see them and their personalities. And the woman is a writing genius. When you read her, you say, well, what is it about her writing that's doing this to me? Everybody, all the letters I get, people say, now I know what you guys went through because I was in prison with you. So the book does that. It puts you in there. My book reminded me of what happened, but her book put me back in.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
Well, hi. Thank you for being here tonight. It's amazing that you're here. It's truly amazing. My question is, can you describe your experience competing in the 36 Olympic Games and shaking Hitler's hand?
Your experience of being in the 1936 Olympics and then shaking Hitler's hand, just the whole experience.
Well, I was the youngest runner on the team, and so I didn't absorb things like the older people, but I do remember when Hitler came in, his people were compelled to stand up and cheer. But when Jesse Owens came in, he got twice the cheers Hitler did. And people knew about Jesse before he came because nothing got him down. If there was any kind of a racist remark, he'd say, hey, that's not my problem, it's his. And that got into the news and people loved it. And so he got that great, huge ovation, and boy, it made my heart jump. And Jesse was, and I was his roommate. And so I know the guy, and he's what I call a peach of a guy. Unfortunately, I was on NBC with him the year before he died. And it's sad that he died young, but he did go through an awful ordeal after coming home in regards to income tax. And same thing happened to Jim Thorpe, and same thing happened to the famous, we call him the Brown Bomber. Yeah, the Brown Bomber, and that was Joe Louis. He was, every white kid in America that I knew, and that was their hero, Joe Louis. He was the same way. Nothing got him down. If somebody criticized black people, that's their problem, not mine. So, and I still think Joe Louis was the greatest boxer of all time, better than Cassius Clay. Because he didn't get up there and swing a lot of punches. He's like a cobra. He just stood there, one jab, and that was it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's great.
Shaking Hitler's hand.
So. Yeah, what was just the feeling like when you actually shook Hitler's hand?
Well, it didn't mean much to me. I was a kid, youngest runner on the team, and when Goebbels came over and asked me to come to meet Hitler, I said, well, I didn't win any medal. He said, he wants to see you. So I went over there, and he just touched hands. He's up pretty high. And he just said, the boy with the fast finish. Because I ran my last lap in they called it a blistering 56 seconds. But I gained 14 pounds on the boat going over eating during the Depression. That was my gold medal. And then in Berlin, in the village, beautiful village, they had a big semicircle building, two stories high. Every door was an entrance to a different country's cuisine. And I tried them all. And I was working hard, but I couldn't. I gained more weight than I could lose, and so I couldn't keep up with the pace. But I always had. No one ever passed me from behind. So the last lap, I sprinted at what the Germans called a blistering 56 seconds. So I gained 50 yards on the leaders, and of course that brought people to their feet. And Hitler, as a result of that, he wanted me to come over and meet him. Right. And the boy with the fast finish, that was it.
Yeah, it's good. Who else wants to come up? Come on, you guys, nobody asks more questions in this class every week. Go ahead.
Hi, I just wanted to thank you so much for coming. It's really an honor to meet you. But I'm just wondering, after the war, if you continued competitive running at all, or if you stuck to a coaching role or something like that?
After the war, did you try competitive running again? How much running did you do after you got back?
Well, when I came back from the war, yes, I was still young enough to run, and I'm a... There were only two or three of us in America that were virtual runners. We could run anything from a 440 to a marathon, and I tried them all. And Dean Cromwell, a great coach we had, when we were losing a meet, he'd put me in two or three races. And one day we were running against Cal, he put me in the mile, the half mile. I won both of those, then I had to run the 2 mile, I won that. And then I ran first leg on the relay, 440. I'm a distance runner. But I came in, I did a 49. That's the best I could do in a 440. But at least he knew I could finish the quarter. So, he worked my tail off. But I had a lot of endurance, and I never got tired. When I broke the world's record or the national record in high school, within 5 seconds I was on the broadcast, and I wasn't breathing. So people give credit to hard work, but you got to give credit to your genes. You've got good genes. You do have the advantage over somebody else.
Louis, if you didn't know, I don't know whether we've mentioned this, I've mentioned it before, but he held the high school mile record for 15 years and the collegiate mile record for 20 years set here at USC. Yep, who's next? Oh, okay.
Victoria. Hi, I just wanted to thank you so much. My father flew B-24s over Germany in 44 and 45, and he really wanted to come meet you, but he just wasn't feeling great today. And I just wanted to ask you, I have a good friend who was in Iraq for 5 years, and he's back now, and his PTSD is pretty crippling. And I would just wonder, you know, advice to current veterans of the Iraq or Afghanistan war and what your advice to them would be.
What your advice would be, she has a friend that just got back from Iraq recently. What's your advice to veterans back from Iraq or Afghanistan? She has a friend that just got back from Iraq dealing with, you know, the difficulties of having been there. What you would say to somebody like that? And her father was a World War II veteran who was going to be here tonight and was a little bit under the weather.
Well, when we got back, they had the Air Corps, they had 5 resorts all set out, and we were allowed to have 2 weeks, all expenses paid, and that's a big help. And then they had scheduled every day for recreation. They get your mind off of the war and stuff like that. That was important to us, but it still didn't help me. But of course, one of the recreations was the Ron Rico Rum Company, free drinks.
Right.
So that didn't help much.
Right.
Yeah, it's I was going to say something about, people asked me how Laura got excited about doing my biography. She wanted to do my regular book, autobiography, but I was already finished with it. Then we became close friends, but then she sent me the book on Seabiscuit, and then I talked to her on the phone, and I said, "Well, how'd you find out about me and my biographer?" She said, "Well, when I was researching Seabiscuit, on the same page when he ran, you ran at SC." Well, it's true, and I don't think anybody here knows this, but in those days, when Seabiscuit ran, they stopped everything in the Coliseum, football or track, until Seabiscuit finished his race, and then we went back to exercise. And so I used to lay on the grass and listen to his race, and I'd run mine the same way. Well, while she was researching Seabiscuit in the papers of that day, she kept running across articles about me, and one of the articles that caught her attention was the Los Angeles Times called our coach Dean Cromwell and said, Louis hasn't been beaten in the mile for 5 years. If he gets beaten this year, who do you think will beat him? And my coach says, Seabiscuit. So that got her going, and then she decided to do the book.
And you're both temperamental runners. I know you've said that before, too, right?
Yeah, we were both the same kind of runners, moody or whatever.
Yeah.
Hi. On a slightly lighter note, Fellenzer mentioned that you were still a big supporter of USC Athletics. Who are some of your favorite athletes of the past 50 years and why?
Being that you're such a supporter of USC Athletics, who are some of your favorite USC athletes of the past few years?
Well, SC's been loaded with athletes. And in the past year, Matt Barkley.
There he is.
Nothing gets him down.
I told him that you're not afraid. If you think that you saw something, a better play, you wouldn't be afraid to tell Pete Carroll, whoever's coaching, if they could have done something better.
Right. Yeah, things happen fast here. I don't know this. This Bush thing and all this hassle but what gets me down is if one athlete breaks the rule, my opinion is they should punish the school, because if the athletic director's job is to let them know what the rules are. If you break it, you're out. They wouldn't break it, but they keep breaking the rules. And so who's being punished? The innocent kids on the team are being punished.
Right.
You take away 2 years of bowl games and everything else, I say they should, any administrators here?
No.
They should fine the school $100,000 for that error and leave the kids alone. It's not their fault.
Yeah, I've heard that. I've heard that suggestion before. Who else? Oh, okay. Next up.
So when you were starting to run in high school, right after your graduation, you were predicted to be one of the first people to break 4 minutes in the mile. And I think without the war, I think you would have done that. I also want to know, what's your opinion on, there's high schoolers nowadays breaking sub four in the mile. Do you think that it's just a generational gap, or is it just the better training surfaces and coaching?
Do you think that they would have had a good chance to have broken the mile, the 4 minute mile, if you had been able to continue training? And what's your feeling about runners today, why they're able to run so close to that, and why the times have been lowered so much over the years?
Well, everything's changed. About 10 years ago, I was at a university in the East, and that's the first time I ran on a red track, a rubber track, and I couldn't believe the difference. We run on this hard clay, and you're not going anywhere. Our shoes, I weighed them. Our shoes weighed three times as much as the current shoes today. All these things come into play. You can pick up, with a light shoe today, I can pick up maybe 2 seconds a lap, and that puts you pretty close to four. And then the tracks that bounce like the rubber tracks, when we ran on hard clay or soft track where your feet slipped. And so it was very difficult to run a 4:10 mile in the old days. But when I ran in the National Collegiates, I was trained to run a 4-flat mile. I was off the team for 2 weeks, and I trained by myself. And I found a secret. My brother was a coach, and we worked it out. And I knew I could run 4-flat, so I was prepared to do it. After I worked out here at school, I went over to the Coliseum at night and ran the stairways. And so my training here and the stairways, I couldn't believe what was happening to me. So when I went back to meet the team in Minneapolis, I made a mistake by telling people. So then I'm in the hotel with Peyton Jordan and a coach Nicholson of Notre Dame. He came up and said, "I came here to warn you, Louis. I just came from a coaches meeting of the East, all the coaches, and they're telling their boys to knock you out of the race tomorrow. Well, I can take care of myself, you know." But I ended up with two-inch gashes in this one and this leg, one gash, a broken rib, and a spike run through my toe. I couldn't believe it. I couldn't get that. What they did, they boxed me in. The first half mile was always around 158. So I was trained to run the second one in 159 or 2-flat. But they knew that, so they boxed me in the whole last half mile, and I couldn't break through. Every time I tried to break through, they come back with the elbow and catch me in the chest and cracked a rib. And so when I finally broke through the last 100 yards, and I like to sprint about 200 yards, and I pulled away from the champion 5 yards, but I realized that the race was slow, so I slowed down like an idiot. And then when the coach came up, he said, "How fast do you think you ran?" I said, "We didn't break 4:20. He said, "You just broke the national collegiate record." So yeah, that day I was ready for it. Mm-hmm. But that was it.
Did you also have your own diet? Did you?
Well, this is during the Depression. You ate what you could get. We ate pretty good. We ate simple food. And we all had a job working. Mm-hmm. Hoover Boulevard went right in front of Tommy Trojan.
Right.
In 1937, the entire campus was under 1 foot of water. And we have a picture of a car pulling a surfboard with a guy standing on it. I'm right in front of Tommy Trojan.
Who else? Yeah, go ahead.
I'm sure you know this, that you're an inspiration to many of us, if not all of us in here. But my question is, who was your inspiration? The person that, I guess, gave you that will to live in those like unbelievable times, like when you're in the raft and in the POW camps?
Good question. He said that you're an inspiration to all of us in this room, and he wondered who your inspiration was when you were going through the toughest times.
Well, my inspiration now is Laura Hillenbrand. She gets out of the house one day a year. We like to talk back and forth, and I haven't been able to talk to her for about 3 weeks because she's bedridden. Out of the house one day a year, I was in Washington. I called her. I wanted to see her. We'd never met. And she's like my own daughter because her husband said, well, she can't talk or write. 6 months at a time, she can't do anything. And then she finally wrote me a letter, said, I can write now, but I can't talk. 2 weeks later, she called me on the phone, and you never know she was ill. I didn't know she was an ill woman until I read it in the paper, and then I couldn't believe it. And so I suffered for 2 years in prison. She suffered for 23 years. So I sent her one of my Purple Hearts. And she was just filled to death again. I said, you suffered a lot more than I did. It's true, the poor woman is, she needs a lot of prayer. I mean, and she's so sweet. And she's my inspiration because she never complains. She's got probably the worst condition you could ever have.
And she's only, what, maybe 44?
Yeah, 45? It's about 43, 44.
Right, right. How about, was there anybody that you were inspired by when you were in the war and going through those really, really tough times?
Well, of course, my hero, my first hero was a miler, Glenn Cunningham. And every kid in a school knew his story where he was burnt in a fire. His legs are not only burnt, but he's burnt through the middle of his back. And they said he'd never walk again. Well, there's the adversity. He overcame it. He was determined to walk. And then when he could walk, he was determined to run. And he ran 6 miles to school every morning. He didn't do too well, but he kept getting better and better. And he became the king of the milers. And how he could run with all that scar tissue is beyond me. So you talk about determination. He had it.
Great. Yeah.
Hi. As you were developing your personal relationship with God after the war, how long did it take you to fully forgive the people who tormented you while you were in the camps and to get over your nightmares of the bird?
When you were developing your relationship with God over those years after the war, how long did it take before you were able to forgive and forgive everything, the people that...
Well, it happened in an instant. While I was still on my knees, I knew it was all over. It's hard to explain, but 10 people gave the book a 5-star rating. One man gave it a 4-star rating. He said, I gave it a 4-star rating because I cannot understand how a person under severe post-traumatic stress can get over it in a matter of a moment. Well, the Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new person. It happened in a matter of a few seconds. I couldn't believe what was happening. I know I didn't have to taper off. I just knew I was through drinking. I was through smoking. I was through chasing around. And I forgave all my guards, including the bird. It's a miracle. And I turned around, and instead of hating the guy, I love him. I want to go back and give him a hug and tell him, hey, I don't resent anything that happened. But then again, you see, when the mayor of Hiroshima, of Noesu, did anything good come out of you being a prisoner for 2.5 years in Japan? Yeah, if it hadn't been for the bird being as mean as he was and beat me up as much as he did, I wouldn't have had the nightmares. And because of the nightmares, I drank. Because of the drinking, my wife's going to leave me. And instead, I end up at Billy Graham's meeting. So I can't hate the bird.
Wow. That's the ultimate positive attitude. Johnny.
Yeah. Mr. Zamperini, first off, thank you so much for being here tonight. It's truly amazing to have you here. I'm just wondering, because you've talked so much tonight about how you've been able to maintain such a positive attitude about what happened during World War II, and in the book, I read about how there were a lot of veterans who died due to physical difficulties from the war. There were just a lot of people who died. Do you have any theories as to why you've been able to stay so physically healthy as well, especially right after the war when you had been through torture?
Good question. Well, with all you went through in the war, how you've been able to stay so healthy and fit when so many veterans have had so many physical problems and don't live lives into their 90s. How have you been able to do it?
Well, you got to really make up your mind what you're going to do. When I went to the VA hospital, it's hard to believe, 1954, I had double kidney failure. And I had to have an operation. They were going to take out my right kidney. And I prayed about it. And I told the doctor, I said, leave it in. He said, I can't do it. He said, you'll sign a release. So I signed a release. They left it in. And the next day, he said it was dead. So the next morning, I'm on my suffering, cut in half. And I hate gas. And that made me sick. He came by my bed in the morning, I'm suffering. And he said, well, Louis, I told you, we're still going to have to take it out. I said, you're going to cut me in the same place? Oh, yeah. And he said, the other kidney's bad, too. We're going to have to operate on that within 6 months. And I thought, man, I'm finished. And then he said, well, there's no doubt the war took about 10, 12 years off of your life. Well, I decided there and then I was going to get those years back. And I've gotten them back. Now, both kidneys are functioning normally.
Wow.
And I'm 94.
Right. Right. Incredible. Incredible. Truly incredible. Yeah. Yes. Go ahead.
Okay. I just had a question about being away from your family for so long and not being able to talk to them, what it was like, what was going through your head as you were coming home to the United States, and then when you first got to see them, what was going through your head and what you were thinking, all the emotions.
Yeah. Carter's on the soccer team here, by the way. Wanted to know what was going through your head and what was it like when you finally were able to greet your family again, when you saw them and what that was like.
Well, that was that's an emotional experience that's hard to explain. First of all, yeah, we suffered in prison camp, but you know, people don't think about family suffering. It's a different kind of suffering, but I felt that my dad and mom, they suffered continually around the clock on a daily basis. In prison camp, we had time off from suffering. And so my brother was in the Navy, and even though he said if Louis has a toothbrush, he can survive anywhere. But he was so worried and distraught over my being missing and declared dead, he lost a lot of weight. I took my time coming home from after the war, repatriation. It took us down to Yokohama. They said, when you go into the building, you get all the Coke and all the donuts and coffee you want. We get off the train, and there's a man there. He said, who's got a good story? And this buddy of mine said, he does. So this guy grabbed me from the Time magazine. Everybody's going in to get their coffee and donuts. And you don't, and man, a whole world to us. I couldn't break loose from this guy. Finally, he turned me loose. I went to the building, and two sergeants grabbed me, and they pushed some powder down my to kill all the bugs. Then I rushed over. There was no coffee, no chocolate, no donuts. I walked around looking for a crumb on the floor. I had to see what a donut tasted like. Hey, now I've got to go to the airport, so I'm walking by the quartermaster. And there's a bunch of boxes there, and I said, hey, what's this? He said, well, they call it K-ration. I said, food, right? And he said, yeah. And I started putting it in my shirt, and he said, Lieutenant, take it easy. You're going to get all the food where you're going. That's what they told me when I came here. And so I go down to Okinawa, and I'm not a registered prisoner of war. My buddies are lined up eating meals. I couldn't get in. You're not a prisoner. I went to the quartermaster to get new clothes. They wouldn't give me clothes. I'm a man without a country. And so then, in Okinawa, I went back to the Red Cross tent, and the girl said, well, help yourself to the candy. So I kept eating Snicker bars. And then an officer came in. She said, maybe he can help you. He was the general's adjutant. He took me up to the general, and he fed me. And they said, are you in a hurry to go home? I said, no, I got to get fattened up. So he put me in charge of a Dr. Eli Lippman from New York, who had an infirmary, big, huge, strong tent, and then an underground infirmary. And So I stayed in a tent, and then a big rope, stiff rope from a pole here over to the outhouse, and then the typhoon came. And man, I knew I was in trouble, and I had stomach trouble, so I had to go to the outhouse, and I started working my way over on the rope, and my feet were being swept out from under me by the typhoon, and I finally got to the outhouse. I just sat down in the outhouse and went up in the air, gone, and I got blown over the side of the hill, slippery mud down the hill, and I couldn't stand up. And I had to crawl back like a lizard. I got back and I knocked on the infirmary door and they let me in. And coming home was as bad as going to Japan. I got to a C-54 airplane. Boy, that's great. I want to fly home in that. But it was full. I had to wait for the next plane. What do you think it was? A B-24. And I just said, no, I can't get on it. I can't get on it. Well, you have to because there's no more planes. This plane goes to Manila. So we flew towards Manila, and they're socked in. They said, land at Loag, northern Luzon, at a fighter strip. So we landed there, a real short strip between two mountains. And the next morning, we got clearance. And so we're trying to take off. We got 40 prisoners in the back. The pilot asked me to come up front with him, the three of us up there. And we're going down that runway, and we know we're not going to make it. Okay, but they bulldozed a berm in front of the runway to keep the ocean from getting on the runway. We looked at each other and we knew this was it. I thought, my God, after all I've been through, I'm going to die. We hit the berm, bounced in the air, and we just floated on the white caps. The white caps went through the bomb bay door and got all the prisoners wet. And we just stayed on the water and just gradually climbed out. Now, about 3 years ago, the guy called me and asked me how I got to Manila. I told him about this situation. He said, well, I was the pilot, and I almost went in my pants. But that was after that, it was free sailing all the way home.
So when you finally saw your family,
well, when I saw my family, that was that would be hard to explain because General Arnold sent a B-25 for me to fly me to Long Beach Airport, and there was my family, and oh, they looked great. I mean, it was just such a nostalgic moment. It would be hard to explain the emotion that took place. It's just you have to experience it. I don't know how you could talk about it or write about it. It's an emotional thing.
Right.
And two sisters, my brother, but see, my brother, in the Letterman Hospital in Frisco, when they came to interview me, I got fattened up. I stayed in Okinawa 2 weeks, he got fattened up. I stayed in Hawaii, and the great Duke Aramoko took me in tow, and I'm eating all this great food, mm-hmm. and I'm putting on weight, and my mother's calling the General Arnold to, why isn't my boy home? So he sent me a red letter order, and I have to tell you what it said. It just said, get your ass back here with every available dispatch. I got the next plane home, Letterman Hospital. My brother went AWOL from San Diego, hopped a plane. He was waiting for me. And he was as skinny as a rail, and here I was fattened up.
Right.
So the press came in, and they grabbed him, took him over in the corner to interview him about his POW life. So that shows you how much he suffered.
Right, right.
They suffered on a daily, minute-to-minute basis. We didn't. It was periodic.
And your brother Pete lived until, what was it, just 3 or 4 years ago? Was he still alive?
Yeah, it's sad that two people that were healthier than me and are both dead. Peyton Jordan, 30 years of coaching. My brother Pete, 40 years of coaching. I go to the VA two or three times a year and they get these little things off of you, things that are pre-cancer. Neither one went to the VA. And I couldn't believe how healthy they were. And then overnight, they had melanoma. So when you're coaching, if you're a coach, wear a broad-brim hat. Peyton and I even were my roommates in college, and I missed the guy. And my brother was in better shape than me. But melanoma got him. Once it's in your bloodstream, you've had it.
Yeah, yeah. Anybody? No, go ahead.
You said that the one word that describes your generation is the word hardy. If you had to describe our generation in one word or phrase, what would that be? And do you have any advice for our generation?
Good question. You talked about the word hardy to describe your generation. What word, if you had one word, would you use to describe their generation? And any advice, anything you'd like to tell them?
Oh, I stick to the one word, hardiness. As kids, I speak to a lot of high school kids. Every kid thinks he's got a problem. They don't realize that their parents have problems too. And they think those are the greatest problems, but I said, hey, it can benefit you. Every time you overcome an adversity, you're becoming more and more hardy. And that hardiness is the answer to a healthy and successful life. And the kids love it. They have something to work on. Instead of giving up or resenting it, just attack it and overcome it. And that's a step up, hardiness. And then another one. We have a lot of adversities. That's why I resent the greatest generation. We were the hardy generation. And the first thing that made us hardy was it's outlawed today, and that is spanking with a belt or a board or whatever. We knew we deserved it, but it really made us hardy. And then came Dr. Spock, the famous doctor, and he set up a new way of punishment, psychology. And then years later, when he saw the kids growing up in America, front page in the LA Times, Dr. Spock says, I am responsible for the nation's brats. And he said, anyone that follows my philosophy is equally responsible. And so, but they kept on following it. And now we got a generation of, drugs and all that. We had drugs in our day, but nobody would touch it. But today, the whole country, actresses, entertainers, I don't know, on TV, I see this Sheen or somebody like that.
Why was I just thinking that?
A blonde girl that's wrapped up in drugs. And, I worked a lot with kids. Drugs are in every school in the system, even strict Christian schools. We found 8 kids taking drugs. And we got that solved. We got treatment for them at Kaiser. So it's a different world. In our day, nobody would touch drugs. No, never. Oh, we'd sneak a cigarette now and then.
Go ahead.
Hi. I'm actually really curious as to how you met your wife, because you just came home and then were married, I thought, like pretty quickly. So I'm really curious as to how you met your wife.
How you met your wife? It seems like you came home and got married pretty quickly. How did you meet her?
Well, the Air Corps, all prisoners that belong to the Air Corps, we were given 4 resorts we could go to for 2 weeks, all expenses paid, and take a buddy with us, one person. And I'd never been to Miami, so I picked Miami. Took my college buddy, SC, Kappa Sig, and
went
to Miami, and they made a movie called The Wedding Crashers. We were the first. When we were at SC.
Never heard that.
We said, look in the paper, so-and-so's getting married Saturday at 6 o'clock in the evening at the Knickerbocker Hotel. Well, we get all dressed up, we go there, and we stand behind the guard at the door, and people walk in and say, oh, hi, Joe, how's the kids? Hi, Joe, how's this, how's that? So we pick that up. Then we go out, come in laughing, hi, Joe, how's the family? And we got in. And then first thing we did, we danced with all the old ladies. And getting good with them, compliment them on their hairdo, on their jewelry, their nice clothes. And then we go and dance with the young girls. Now, if anything happened, the old ladies would defend us. And then when the young girls got suspicious, they'd say, well, whose friends are you? We always told them the truth. We crashed the party. They loved it. They said, oh, the party was dull till you guys got here. So, yeah, we did that almost at least twice a month.
The wedding crashing circuit.
And that got me used to gourmet food.
So that's how you met Cynthia.
Well, I met Cynthia in Miami. We snuck into the top club was the Deauville. Bernard McFadden was a health expert in the world at that time. And it was a close, private club. And we climbed over the wall, laying on the beach. And then these two girls come out. And one was my wife. The other one was Ambassador Harriman's niece. And we got to talking, and they were real nice. And Harry is telling my story. And then she said, well, whose friends are you? I said, well, that was all the truth. We snuck in, we climbed over the wall, and they thought it was great. And then she said, well, I'll tell you what, I'll leave your name. We have a cabana. You can come in at will whenever you want to, and you can get in free. So we had a private club. So she left her name there, so we came back again. And then I tried to date her, but she was dated. Two Macs, Mac Fruhoff and Mac Deering McCormick, mm-hmm. the farming tool. And so I said, how about a date in the daytime? Fine. So the Army Air Corps had programmed every day, deep sea fishing, Ron Rico Rum Company playing a dance here. And so we did it in the daytime, and we fell in love. Wow. And so then she canceled her date with the two Macs. And then we're standing on the beach, and just like a movie, the moon is coming up, and there's a streak across the water right up to the beach. And I thought, boy, what an opportunity. Mm-hmm. So that proposed, and that was it.
She maxed out and took you instead.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Let's go to the last, you guys, the last two? Last three.
Okay. Thanks for being here. Your wedding crashing story sets up my question perfectly. You have a great sense of humor. Now, during your time serving our country, is there anything that you can think of today that still makes you laugh?
Said you have a great sense of humor. How about today, when you think about the country? Is there what makes you laugh today? What keeps you in a good mood when you think about our country?
Well, makes you reflecting back when you served our country.
Yeah, when you as you reflect back on serving our country.
And what was the question about humor?
Yeah, about what gives you what keeps you in good spirits when you think about looking back serving your country.
It's absolutely essential that you have the Bible has the answer for longevity. Have a cheerful attitude at all times. And so even when you break your hip, all things work together for good. That's part of it. So you don't let anything negative in your life, nothing. Breaking a hip, you say that's negative. I don't accept it as negative. I said it works together for good. I want to see what the good's going to be, and I went to the hospital, and it was worth it. All the nurses, and buying the book, and the cheerfulness, and it rubbed off on other patients. So only good came out of it.
Yeah, good. Okay.
I just wanted to know, when you were able to return home, how difficult was it for you to have to share all of your hardships with your family and your friends, and what kind of prompted you to want to have your story published so that it could be shared with all of us?
Yeah. How difficult was it when you came home to tell your story to people, and then how did you feel about wanting to have it published so you could share it with so many more people?
Well, at first, when you first get home, you don't want to talk about it. But then I talked to a professor of psychology, and he said, you know, the more you talk about it, when you retain it inside, it's eating on you, and you got to let it out. Now, it's hard at first, and actually, I had to take a flask with me. Yeah, at a breakfast, Riverside Breakfast Club, and pour a couple of jiggers into the coffee to get enough nerve to get up and talk. And but the more I talked about that, the less it bothered me. So now I get letters I've been getting them for years from kids that had fathers in the war, and they said, my father just sits around and he won't talk about the war. I said, well, you got to get him to talk about it and get it out. And so the more you talk about it, the less it bothers you. But if you retain it, it's going to eat on you like cancer.
Yeah. I want to thank our guests that came tonight. Let you guys know, by the way, I didn't say this earlier, but you have to come back in 2 weeks and take the midterm. That's kind of the deal. Jeff, we'll arrange it with you online or something like that. Louis, by the way, is doing a book signing tomorrow night at the Cannery in Newport Beach for you guys that are either are going to be down there or know somebody that will be. From 6 to 8, he'll be doing a signing tomorrow night at the Cannery.
Well, we get around at El Cholo, you know.
Yeah, I told him about that, actually.
Well, we expected about, I was on a big radio broadcast, and they made the announcement. We expected about 50 people. 300 showed up.
Wow.
And they're there all night signing books.
I just want to know if we can all come as a class to the movie premiere when the movie comes out. Can we get that done on the red carpet?
Well, I met twice now with Universal in the last 2 weeks. Yesterday, 4 hours at the studio. And they got a guy named, oh, God, what's his name?
Gosling, Franco? Right? Yeah, James Franco. And then
they got him. That's what they want. They want him to play the part. And then they keep interviewing me. And I said, well, hey, the book tells everything. He said, but what they want to do, they want to evaluate your personality, I guess, something like that.
Yeah.
And they were a great bunch. So that's been going on for 2 weeks. And they said, well, it's going to take a year to put this together. We got an Academy Award writer, an Academy Award director.
Yeah.
And then I said, then how long to make the movie? He said, another year. I said, hey, I'm 94. Let's get this thing.
Well, Louis, you've honored us by being here tonight. I've always said this, that when you consider what he's accomplished athletically and what his service to our country, you know, his acts of heroism and what he stands for and how he's lived his life, to me, this is the greatest Trojan of them all, right here. Mm-hmm.
Right on.